Do you know where the food you put on the table comes from? And more importantly, do your kids know? Well, according to one survey, a third of kids aged 5 to 12 didn't know tomatoes grew on vines. We are sitting down to chat to someone who is working very hard to change that. She's been a restaurant owner chef for over 30 years, written 18 books about food, and has received the Order of Australia for the services to the hospitality industry. Now, through her initiative, the Stephanie Alexander Kitchen Garden Foundation, she is changing the way school students see, interact, and respond to real food education. Stephanie Alexander, thank you for joining us at Mums at the Table.
It's my pleasure.
It's lovely to have you here. Now, your program's been growing since 2001 and you're in, I understand, 11% of schools around Australia. Congratulations, that's fantastic.
It is fantastic and it keeps on growing.
Good, I love the pun there, with the garden. I want to sort of go back a little bit as in to around that 2001 time when you first sort of started getting your head around all of it. What actually prompted you to start a program like this to see that there was a need?
Well, I heard the public discourse everywhere in the magazines, newspapers about how people were concerned about the way children ate and the implications of that for obesity, diabetes, blah, blah, blah. And I got really enraged because I read all this stuff and nowhere was there anything about pleasure. Nowhere was anything about enjoyment. And as far as I'm concerned, I believed then and I still believe that nobody changes behaviour through being threatened or having fingers wagged at them or hearing about traffic lights or pyramids or lists. And that really what was needed was an intervention at school where children were able to do things that they really loved. And so I managed to persuade, it wasn't very hard, a wonderful school principal to let me have a go at creating an edible garden in the school grounds and finding a little space in the school where children could actually cook simple things and a space they could sit around a table and share. And that really was the genesis of the whole thing. And what's more, it has made a huge difference. Within, say, 2 months of the children doing this on a regular basis, they did have an entirely different understanding and interest in everything to do with food. Digging holes, putting up binge supports, picking salad leaves, putting a salad together, estimating what the dressing should be. I mean, it's amazing to see.
It's great that you had a school principal that was so willing to come on board. Have you found it sort of relatively easy to sort of get this program to grow and spread?
I think relatively easy is the idea. It's a big change and it does involve finance, and for some schools that they're starting very small, and we encourage that. If they don't feel that they've got the facilities or the community support to really get right in there and have an extensive garden, we say start small, and the impact that this program will have will allow it will grow organically.
I'm asking you this question from someone who doesn't really enjoy cooking too much. Mm-hmm. What is it about cooking? What is it that you find that's pleasurable, that you want the kids and everyone to actually embrace?
Well, it's a great sense of personal independence that you are therefore able to control your future, really. You are not at the mercy of the commercial manufacturers. You do not feel you have to go and take something from a freezer or in order to have something to eat. You are, after all, one day going to be an independent adult, we hope. And also you're not going to have unlimited funds, and eating out in a cafe or a restaurant twice a day becomes actually not only very expensive but very boring. And the satisfaction the kids get is amazing, and their self-esteem, blossoms. They feel very proud of what they achieve.
Yeah. I think I was sort of surprised to read that stat where kids didn't know that tomatoes grew on vines, and I think that, you know, milk and sort of cheese came from cows. That sort of blew me away. What changes are you seeing? Because you started back in 2001, so you would have seen a whole load of students sort of come through the system. What changes are you seeing long-term from what you've done?
It's very hard to see the long-term changes, and I always said to anyone who was interested in the program, we can't promise an instant result. We're not looking for measuring people's waistlines, because that's another nightmare scenario.
Yes, it is.
It's not helpful. What we really want is young people to appreciate and respect fresh food and to enjoy it and to make that part of their life forever. So we are we try to find the alumni of the program, but they sort of scatter once they move out of the primary school system, and it hasn't been so easy. But really, right at this moment, the University of Melbourne is looking for alumni of these programs to take part in a survey of how they feel 10 years on.
I was going to say, because you've already done some research into this program already, what are some of the findings?
Well, what we've found so far is that, firstly, it's voted by the children themselves their favourite part of school.
Oh, win.
Oh, wow.
So that's pretty good. Yeah. And the
Is that because they get to get out of maths and English and PE?
Because maths and English are all part of the program.
Are they? You know,
they're making the pizza.
Part of the
fractions,
curriculum.
You know. That's let's how many teaching. If you could divide this pizza into eight, what happens if you've only got six, if you've got 16 people, or all that sort of stuff, and measuring and volume and environmental stuff. So we try to integrate it with the full curriculum, so that the schools can't say this is an add-on and we haven't got time to do it. Mm. So there's so much literacy, numeracy involved in it, also cultural understanding, because almost every school in Australia represents cultural diversity and we try to embrace that.
Love it.
So what would one of the highlights, like have you had a highlight of doing this gardening in the schools?
Well, I think the highlight for me is watching the pleasure the children get and their new attitude towards eating yummy things that are wonderful and freshly grown.
So you've been working with the children. Do you know if they've been able to influence their parents' behaviour at all?
They certainly have.
Ooh.
Whenever
way?
I visit a school, the parents who are there as a volunteer or just to say hello come up to me and they say, you have no idea how this has changed my son, my daughter. He or she is now much more interested in what we buy as a family, much more interested to make suggestions, and says things like, can we cook the spinach and ricotta roly-poly that we made at school this weekend? Yeah. That sort of thing.
Which is great. So it's transferring from what they're learning at school into home, which is what you really want to do.
Yes.
Well, speaking of homes as well, it's like, what is it that parents can do? Like, you know, if their kids don't go to school that has the program, what can parents do at home to help?
Well, provide great modelling. All eat beautiful food and eat together.
I think I love that, eat together at the table. I look forward to that every day. I love sitting down with the kids and sort of having our meal. You obviously love food. You're trying to get, you know, that love to sort of spread around. But where did your love of food actually come from?
From sitting around a table with my family, seven people every night, and four kids, my mother, my father and my grandfather. So there was a double extra generation. And every night of my childhood, we had beautiful food, some of it cooked from the garden, and I just grew up thinking that was how everybody lived.
So was your mother a really good cook? Did you learn from her?
Yes, she was a very good cook, but she was also very curious, and she liked to understand how food happened in other countries and other cultures long before she had travelled or had the funds to travel.
So she certainly sort of brought everything to the table, literally. OK, I've got to ask this question. What's your go-to meal when you're tired or when you come home and you've had a long day? Because we've got a lot of mums watching. What's your go-to meal?
Well, for me, it's probably green salad and probably eggs if it's really go-to and no time, or fish.
OK. Well, I love it because we all need the tips. Well, we've actually got two of Stephanie's books to give away. So we want you to write to us. It's the first two people to write to hello@thetabletv.com. Write in, let us know that you want this book and it will be yours. That's got so many recipes in it. Now, this is your latest book out, isn't it?
It is, and it's doing very nicely.
So what was the reason behind this one?
Just because I feel there are people who have somehow slipped through the net and haven't learnt how to cook. So I want them to understand that it's really easy and that every technique they'll come across, I've explained it.
OK, because this is quite a big book. I was going to say, there must be an amazing amount of recipes in here.
There's 300 recipes.
Oh.
And every one of them I've explained any technique that comes up, from how to prepare a cake tin to, I don't know, how to deal with a vanilla bean or how do you open a pomegranate.
You can't go
great
wrong.
For new cooks.
You're going to need it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well,
new
thank
cooks,
you so much.
Any age and any gender.
Yeah.
Loved having you here, Stephanie. Thank you so much for joining us. We really appreciate it.
My pleasure.
And ladies, it's been lovely to have you here. Always a pleasure, never a chore. Thank you so much for joining us. We can't wait to have more topics to chat to you about next time. See you later.